Today on the Loose Show, I'm going to present to you an interview I did with Randy Parraz of the Citizens for a Better Arizona, the recall effort on Russell Pearce. Here's Randy Parraz. Hi, Randy.
Hello, how are you doing?
I'm fine. I'm glad you're here. Tell us about the Citizens for a Better Arizona recall of Russell Pearce.
We were starting out just a loose form coalition of concerned citizens, started talking about Arizona once it became clear from the elections that Russell Pearce then became president of the Senate. And a lot of folks just were really upset about that. We felt that he didn't really have a past history of being able to bring people to the table or to carry an agenda that can act on behalf of the, you know, over 6 million residents of Arizona. So we started having conversations, and all those conversations, we started talking about how do we hold them accountable. And so the idea of a recall started surfacing, but first we wanted to really, you know, put Russell Pearce on notice. So we did that on January 10th and said, look, we want you to, you know, do the people's work, focus on the budget, focus on job creation, health care, and education. So we're going to see what type of bills you're going to really be pushing or introducing over the next 21 days. As we got closer towards, you know, the 31st, which would have been the 21st day of our notice, it just became clear that he was not going to be moving, he was just moving the same old direction, really using issues that are going to be more divisive and not really focusing on what we care most about. So that's when we ended up forming our political recall committee on the 28th, which is a Friday. And then we went up there with a group of people to file it for the recall petition on the 31st, which was a Monday.
He ignored your call for accountability.
Yeah, he ignored that event of the day of what we did on the 10th. We waited in the lobby with about 50 people, and instead of coming out, like the other senators were doing, to move from the Senate side to the House side, he actually took the tunnel, which he found out something's rarely done by any elected official, take the tunnel from one side to the next, because people usually just walk across. We said that day we went to his office, we served him a notice, we actually invited him to a town hall meeting on the 22nd where another 30 people came out to talk about what was going on with Russell Pearce and the concern we had in terms of him being the president of the Senate. He did not respond to that. Of course, he did not show up, but no response. We did him a letter, we emailed him, we called his office. So we were trying to be reasonable in the sense of reaching out to someone, you know, holding something in his own district, and he just did not even respond to constituent concerns.
The recall effort needs about 7,500 signatures. Can you tell us how the recall effort is going so far?
We've already surpassed 500 signatures. We're moving forward. It's been a week of, you know, some paid canvassing, some volunteering, and we're looking at we've signed a number of petitions out to individuals who are going to start taking them around in their own communities, their own neighborhoods. So we've been sending them both Republicans in that district as well as Democrats. So it's going to be as well, and also independent. So it's a pretty interesting mix of people who just do not care for the policies or the leadership style of Russell Pearce.
And neither do I. And I don't know anybody who does like his policies and all of the recently introduced bills, which are so against social justice. It's almost, he's basically, I feel as though Russell Pearce is spitting in the face of the federal government.
Yeah, I think that's a pretty good assessment.
Right. I think it's ridiculous to spend the effort to try to redefine or revise the 14th Amendment when Arizona needs jobs and infrastructure and accountability. It's ridiculous. I'm fully in favor of the recall of Russell Pearce and for the recall of Jan Brewer and for the recall of any of these Republicans who are distracted from the real true business of the state.
Yeah, and I think it's incumbent upon us as citizens of Arizona to really, you know, hold these folks accountable. And so if there's any a time when it's proper to invoke the statutory authority, you know, the legal means by which to remove someone for not really, you know, fulfilling the duties of their elected official, I think Russell Pearce has really surpassed that threshold.
I'm glad you're doing this. I wondered what happened to you after the election. Can you tell us more about what you've been up to since the election of last year?
Yes. After election, I went into another little project. It was called the Latino Early Voter Initiative. We called it the Levi Project. I was trying to encourage people, especially Latino voters who have been underperforming, to come out and use the early vote sites to vote, and then to try and create a buzz that the election actually started on October 2nd, not November 2nd, and that people could kind of go into these early vote sites and to actually vote. So it was kind of late in the game, but it was kind of a way to try to change people's habits and their attitudes about voting and not waiting, and not seen as election day, but as an election month. So I did that, and after that, I took some downtime, and then I traveled. I came back. I was also talking with the Department of the School of Social Transformation at ASU, And they ended up hiring me as an associate faculty. So I'm teaching a course on social transformation at ASU at this very same time as well.
Oh, great. Great. Yeah. I have a question for you. Do you remember the public service announcement or the commercial telling Latinos not to vote? Do you remember that?
I think that was something that happened in Nevada, didn't it?
I don't know where it was. I can't remember. It was
the short angle people in Nevada. It was related to the Harry Reid for U.S. Senate race, and that's why I heard that they actually were blatantly encouraging people not to vote.
Did that factor into your decision to get involved with helping Latinos get registered to vote?
No, I didn't always have an interest in doing that, especially when it's coming out this whole year of 1070 and the attack on the immigrant community and the attack on Latinos and racial profiling. I just wanted to see if we can somehow, get some more attention and have people. I mean, I had this vision of having people out standing outside of the recorder's office and waiting in line to vote. We had also people camping out the night before October 2nd or 6th, I think it was the first day, to kind of come out. And we actually did something like that in Phoenix and in Tucson. Tucson people actually stayed the whole night and waited to be the first people to vote in Pima County.
Right. Right. So Latinos are coming out to vote, but we need everybody to come out and vote, right?
That's right. That's mm-hmm. right.
Well, I just like to ask you, where did you go for your vacation?
I went to Rome, Italy.
My goodness.
Spent 10 days there.
That was the birth of the Republic.
Exactly.
Right. Did you see the Parthenon?
Pretty much was able to walk the whole city over that period of time because there was no rush. And so it was a really time well spent. So I really enjoyed it.
Right. If I had my choice to do a vacation, that's probably where I would go. It would be Italy or Greece to see the cradle of civilization.
Yep.
And they're a lot more civilized there than we are here in Arizona.
I can tell you that's for sure.
Yeah.
I remember crossing the streets there, and a police officer was in a car, and I bumped in front of him. I mean, I almost got in front of his car. He just smiled, honked and smiled, and even, it's no big deal. Whereas here, they probably pull you over and pat you down.
Yeah, it's getting worse. What do you think of the new law 1225? It's the one that makes smuggling an easy afternoon activity. It changes the punishment of human smuggling from a class 4 to a class 3, and it eliminates the definition of smuggling for sex or labor. Now, anybody who just picks up anybody, if they're undocumented, even if they don't know that they're undocumented, can be charged for human smuggling.
Exactly. I think, it can be something, if you just read on its face, it may sound, oh, you're trying to go after those hard criminal elements, but in terms of when it actually gets implemented and how it's actually applied, I mean, that's where we have to be careful. Because anytime, you're writing a bill up and that many Republicans jumping on board, I think that's a problem. Especially in that legislature, given how conservative it is, so I would look twice at what they're trying to accomplish. They have bills now going on to trying to, turn county workers into INS agents when it comes to public housing, when it comes to education,
right.
In terms of, checking the students. I mean, it's just going on and on. The 14th Amendment, the birth bill for the president. Now they got this other committee where they want to take, they can have a majority of people to say that this is not a good law, they don't have to follow it at the federal level. I mean, it's just unbelievable. He thinks, Russell Pearce, this is the United Counties of Arizona. He thinks this is a republic. He thinks this is something separate from everything else. I have to laugh at it. It's actually happening. So that's the frustration. This is not some comedy we're watching on TV. This is real life politics in Arizona. That's going to impact real people and real families. So that's what's really driving our effort to really hold them accountable. You know what? You're going to have a fight in your hands, and just give us 60, 90 days and watch what happens here in Mesa.
It's a useless fight. We've got so much rebuilding to do. And when I think of everything that has happened here in Arizona within the last year alone, not even a year, it's madness. And I wonder, why is it that all of these Republicans in Arizona are taking these positions to the point of legislation? It's madness.
Right. Right. I think a lot of people were asleep at the wheel. A lot of people didn't think it'd be that bad. A lot of people didn't realize, this is the same Russell Pearce maybe 2 or 4 years ago. They're like, oh, he's very extreme. I don't have to worry about him. All his bills will get vetoed. And then he's now has worked his way, not from the far right, even though some of his views, he's now right there in the middle of politics. He has now moderated himself as an extreme in terms of he's got a position of power where he determines all the rules at the Senate. He controls all that.
So that's my alarming. That's my cause of concern. That's why we can't, you know, I can't just sit back and watch this happen. We have to have a fight.
Right.
We can do things at the legislature itself. There's nothing that has more teeth right now than a recall effort. But the specific number of signatures we got to get to show that he's losing his credibility and that people are starting to think differently about his leadership.
When is the official end of the recall? I believe May 31st.
Well, it depends. For our petition, I think it's right around June 1st. For someone else, the other group, maybe they're 3 days before. I mean, it's whatever. Whenever you file a petition, you have 120 days to get your signatures in.
120 days. Okay. I want this recall to take place. But, if I can play devil's advocate with you.
Go ahead.
Some people have said that there's no sense in a recall without having a reasonable candidate in line to possibly replace Russell Pearce. That's what some people say, but I believe, and I bet you'll agree, that it's better to have nobody than to have Russell Pearce in place.
Someone would come out with the right party, the right religion, with the right background, that will be willing to speak for the community and will be able to beat Russell Pearce. Knowing what's even more important to me is not just to win the special election, but to beat him again if he tries to come back. And so that's why it's probably going to be someone who's a Republican, more moderate, someone who's probably from the LDS community, someone who's got a track record, comes from one of the prominent families. Those qualities of all, I mean, that's why I'm in this too. I'm not saying just to recall, I want to win. I want him to be gone. And so I feel pretty confident that we will have that type of candidate and that this type of process will create more room for maneuverability for prominent Republicans, people with money and power and prestige, to say, you know what, this is our opportunity. He's now been recalled. It's our opportunity to get this thing right.
Right. And I hope this will put the kibosh on Russell Pearce. No kidding. Well, Randy Parraz, I want to thank you for being on the Lose Show today.
Just one last thing I'd like to add, people. Know we have a website. It's recallpearce.com. If you can go to, you can volunteer on there. You can contribute. You can download a petition. Unfortunately, only those District 18 can actually sign the petition. Mm-hmm. But there's all those sorts of ways you can help our efforts. So we look forward to, we want to turn this into a statewide campaign.
Recallpearce.com. Recallpearce.com. Well, we like to make fun of people like Russell Pearce on the Lose Show. He's so well known by now to keep repeating the mantras, what part of illegal don't you understand? He says that. He also says, rule of law, rule of law.
Rule of law. I don't make the law. I enforce the law.
Illegal is illegal.
Blame your father. Shame on him.
Rule of law.
I don't make the law. I enforce the law.
Illegal is
illegal. Blame your father. Shame on him.
Rule of law.
I don't make the law. I enforce the law.
Illegal is illegal. Blame your father.
Except though, when here's an exemption for constitutional issues. That's the rule of law doesn't apply there because he wants to change it. So there's something wrong. He's totally a contradiction.
And this is just gossip. We certainly haven't gotten into the kind of person that he is. We're just talking about him as a legislator. And we don't need the kind of legislation that he is pumping out.
No, it's all, like I said, if this was like a comedy or a play, it would be it's something that people all want to go watch and it'd be great entertainment. But unfortunately, it's just unbelievable. Here's someone who talks the talk about being before the law, being for this, and yet he wants to pass legislation that will limit the people's ability to the right to a jury when it comes for a personal injury. He wants to change the 14th Amendment. He wants to do all these different things that are about changing the Constitution of the United States of America. So I think he should resign and run for Congress if he's so interested in federal issues. But until then, he's really focused on what we care about most in the state of Arizona, and it's not those issues he's pushing right now. So we got to prove that. That's why greatness recall is important.
He's regressive.
Oh, yes.
So, recallpearce.com, recallpearce.com. Go to recallpearce.com. Thank you for being on the Lose Show, Randy.
Thank you. Thank you for the time. We'll keep you posted as things develop.
Thank you, Randy Parraz. Thank you. Thank you very, very much. Thank you, Randy.
Thank you. Thank you very much.